Welcome everyone to the local sports coffee shop, the show where we delve deep into great sports talk and even better coffee. I'm your host Shane Shackford, and I am thrilled to have you join us for another exciting episode. Before I get started, I'd like to take a moment to thank our incredible listeners. Your support means the world to me, and I'm grateful for each and every one of you who tunes in week after week. Thank you so much for being part of our growing community. And remember, if you enjoy the show, don't forget to subscribe or follow us on your favorite podcast platform so you never miss an episode. And if you really love what I do, consider leaving me a review. Your feedback helps me improve and reach even more listeners who share my passion for great sports talk and better coffee. So now, without further ado, let's jump right into today's episode and explore the fascinating world of sports and coffee. So sit back, relax, and get ready to sip your brew as we embark on another emotional joyride together here on the Local Sports Coffee Shop. Hey guys, what's going on? This is your host, Coach Shaq, coming to you live from my secret bungalow hid deep in East Tennessee Hills. Not really, I'm down here in Lower Arthur, Tennessee. Thank you all so much for joining me for another episode of the Local Sports Coffee Shop. I'm tickled to death you're here. I'm tickled to death that you decided to spend a little time with me. I really appreciate that. Today's episode, I think you pretty well know where we're going with this thing. Considering everything that's going on, about an hour 45 minutes north of here in a little locale called Lexington, Kentucky, it's absolutely getting ready to get crazy up there. If it ain't already, it's pretty well crazy up there right now. You got a situation up there. You got John Calipari. This is not a tape program, Stephen Ray Black. If I was sitting in Lexington right now, I'd have tape recorder on me. I'd have Liz follow me around with a camera taking pictures of what's going on. And if I was interviewing for that job, you'd know about it because I couldn't keep it secret. I just couldn't do it. But anyways, you know, the search at Kentucky right now is full throttle for the next head basketball coach at Kentucky. And it's crazy, just to put it real politely. But we're going to talk a little bit about that. We're going to talk a little bit about John Calipari. I feel like some things need to be said. Got our always popping What's Brewing coming up, but everything else is going on in the world of sports. Things go on. I mean, you know, it's not just one thing. It's a lot of things. So really excited to get into you with that. But before we get started, I do want to mention our sponsors. We have a new one that we'd like to get a little bit of publicity for. It is, let me find my information here. It is Mike Taylor for Bell Kenworth Attorney. In the Republican primary is May 21st, 2024. As you can see there, his qualifications stand out. If you get a chance to vote for him, I'm sure the committee and Mr. Taylor would appreciate that. So remember, when you vote for Mike Taylor for Commonwealth Attorney. He is a new sponsor for the program, and we deeply appreciate that. Our other sponsors have been rock solid for us too as well, and I'm so thankful for them. I'd like to mention them right now before we get started. Home Helpers, of course, is our title sponsor. Lemonade's Boutique, the Blue Room Billiards Hall, Pineville Pawn Shop, and of course Mike Taylor for Commonwealth Attorney. If you're interested in sponsoring the program, we would love to talk to you. There's my email right there, shane.shackelford@icloud.com. definitely, you know, if you'd be interested, we would be interested in talking to you, see what we can do to help each other out. So that being said, do want to mention our title sponsor, of course, Home Helpers, for what they do for our program. We can never thank them enough. And if you're looking for senior care for an aging parent or loved one, if you're looking for help for a working parent who could use an extra hand, Home Helpers of Southeast Kentucky are the caregivers to help you. For seniors, family, and those recuperating, Home Helpers plans are tailored just for you. Call Home Helpers for a free in-home consultation at 606-657-9441. Home Helpers, making life easier for you. Call Home Helpers today at 606-657-9441 or visit us online at homehelpershomecare.com/London, Kentucky. Thank you so much to the folks at Home Helpers. I'm ready to get started. I'm excited to talk for this show. I really am. I've had a lot of pent up things to say, and I can talk this one out tonight, guys. As you know, right now the search in Kentucky is leaning toward a certain coach. We've heard the names Danny Hurley from Connecticut has turned it down. Nate Oates from Alabama has turned it down. Donovan hasn't heard. Billy Donovan has from the Bulls hasn't heard from Kentucky as of yet, according to him. The name that we're leaning on right now is Scott Drew from Baylor. And I will get into that a little bit. There's kind of I won't say a rift. I think there's a group of Kentucky fans that are, I don't know, I wouldn't say mad, or I wouldn't say they hate it or whatever, that they are heavily on the fence, and justifiably so. I think that is the going rate, I guess, if you will, that with Coach Drew, you know, can he handle the program and things like that. I want to talk about that further in a minute. But before I do get into him, I want to talk about John Calipari. I do. I feel like that, you know, we need, as a fan base of the University of Kentucky, I think we owe him a thank you. I firmly feel like that. I feel like that we owe him a thank you for what he did in 15 years in Lexington. I remember when he came in 2009, somewhere in there, 08, 09, somewhere in there. We're coming off Billy Gillespie. And, you know, if you think back with Billy Gillespie, he wasn't bad as far as bad. I mean, you look at what he did. He won back-to-back 20-win seasons at Kentucky. I think he went 40-24, something like that. Now, again, we weren't working the program we needed to be. I understand that. But big picture, I mean, it wasn't his coaching that was a problem with Gillespie. It was the fact that he couldn't handle the media, the scrutiny, the people over top of him. In Texas, you know, he's out there, even at Texas A&M, he was still a little bit of he could fade in and out of the community. If he wanted to go to a bar and have a drink or whatever, he could do that because Texas, as you know, is a football state. Had he been the head coach at Texas A&M football, now that's a different story. But basketball, you know, some people not, may know him, and he had a good run too at A&M. He got, I think, got the Aggies to the either the Sweet 16 or Elite Eight, one or the other. So, you know, he was a hot name. People had gotten tired of Tubby, and you know, for whatever reasons, and you know, they were plenteous, if you will. So, you know, you had 2 years of Gillespie. You could tell, I think I told somebody when I watched the press conference with Gillespie, he looked overmatched at the press conference before he had coached a minute and done the first Billy Gillespie show. Before any of that, he was over his head. You could tell. Immediately, you could tell. You just had that feeling that it was not going to break good for Kentucky or for him. But, again, 20-win seasons, yeah, he did that. He did. They had good backcourt, Ramil Bradley, Joe Crawford. Had a really good backcourt. But, you know. So, that being said, John Calipari shows up in Lexington and wanted a job. And wanted to be at Kentucky, wanted to, if you will, he wanted to smoke. He wanted it all. Give it to him. And the 15 years that he worked in our program, guys, we had some great moments. We would be amiss to say, oh, it's been so bad with Calipari. Oh, it's been so bad. We've done this. Now, again, the last 3 to 4 years, it's been rough, especially tournament play, you know, March. March has been bad for a Kentucky basketball fan. It has. We know that. But, you know, by and large, you look at his record, you know, over 15 years at Kentucky, he was 4-10 and 122. He had 6 SEC titles, 32 tournament wins, a national title, 4 Final Fours. I mean, it's hard to say, you know, it was a bust truthfully, you cannot say it was a bust. I mean, John Calipari done a good job. He really did. Now I say that, and I know you guys are sitting there thinking, well, Shaq, if it was so bad, why would you get rid of him? Well, it's almost a deal, and you guys that coach, if you're watching this, you know what I'm about to say. After a certain period of time, the dynamic changes, and it's not a good relationship. Put to it's a marriage. I mean, truthfully, it is. And you know, if you find that, like, you know, with being Elizabeth, she's my soulmate. I love her. She knows what I'm going to say. I know what she's going to say. It's all there. But there's times that, you know, everybody runs into rough spots, and I think the rough spots at Kentucky started showing up from the COVID year on. I think that was by and large, the problem with Calipari. And, you know, the years of not having great tournament runs caught him. And, you know, it's like, you know, he talked about in his introductory press conference in 08-09, he said, you know, we hang banners for national titles and Final Fours. We do, you know, and when you're not hanging those banners, you know, when you're not Elite Eight, Final Four, national title game, national champion, you're not getting a banner. You know, if you hung banners, if we hung SEC banners, I mean, you know, that's different. I mean, we'd hang them all the way around up and start a second layer going around the top again, you know, but Kentucky doesn't do that. So I think Cal done as well overall as anybody could ask. I really feel that way. I do. I think that he got tired of the Kentucky pressure. I think he got tired of trying to hold up that standard over and over and over again. Even when he came in, he said, this is a 10-year job. A coach can last 10 years at Kentucky. And then after that, it's time to move on. He lasted 15. So give him credit, you know. But the last four, yes, there were struggles. They are. And I'm not going to sit and browbeat the struggles. I don't. I think that has been done. We can do that as fans until the cows come home. But, you know, I think it's worth mentioning that John Calipari left the program in better condition than he found it under Billy Gillespie. I feel that way. Now, the talent, you know, if you look at the roster, you know, we've got everybody starting to move now. It's starting the process of moving on, or the recruits opening up, you know, their recruitment again. And I understand that. I get that, you know. And I agree, Scotty. It is. I mean, it's one of the toughest jobs in all sports. Anywhere. You know, me and my nephews were talking today. You know, there's a certain, you know, sports teams that have the name recognition. You know, you've got, pressure-wise, I mean, Dallas Cowboys, New York Yankees, Boston Red Sox, Boston Celtics, you know, Los Angeles Lakers, I mean, Kentucky Wildcats, North Carolina Tar Heels. I mean, you know, you can get into that with Duke and Carolina and Kansas and those programs. You know, there's a different pressure. And there's no question that Kentucky is that. It has that pressure about it. And for Cal, the last 15 years is a testament to him and his ability to ride the highs and lows. But I think what happened was the lows got down to a point that, you know, a change needed to be made. You know, some of the things he said over the years, when he first – you know, would give Kentucky fans a little jab or whatever. Kentucky fans would take it in stride. Yeah, we're this, we're that. You know, but we're winning, you know, especially the years 11, 12, 14, and 15 going to Final Fours and then at the 38-0 team. I mean, national title. You know, people are more willing to take a jab, if you will. Then you get to the last 4 years and the 9-16 year, and then the year after that, get beat by 3-seed Kansas, and then the year next 2 years, St. Peter's, and then this year, Oakland. People ain't as willing to take jabs anymore. Fans ain't. They're not, because that you don't have winning as the blanket behind that. So, you know, I get it. I get it. But, you know, again, you know, some of the things Cal said in his, when he said goodbye effectively to BBN, you know, he talked about a fresh start. And in my opinion, it couldn't come at a better time for both Kentucky and John Calipari. Calipari needed to move on. Kentucky needed another voice. And he even said that, you know, it's time for another voice. You need another voice. And that happens. That really and truly happens. You know, but again, you know, it gets to the point, you know, he even said you feed the beast until you run out of food and then the beast eats you. That's Kentucky basketball. That's the beast. And, you know, you can feed it, but when you run out of food, and you run out of, you know, nourishment, it's going to get it somewhere. And the way that they got it was John Calipari. So I don't think he was like, you know, some people would say, well, he's just trying to set himself up as some type of martyr, you know, oh, you mean people of Kentucky have destroyed me, whatever. I don't think so. He's not a martyr. The man had $80 million contract. If that's a martyr, make me a martyr. Give me an $80 million contract, and I'll be a martyr all day long. But, you know, I don't think that, you know, he by any stretch was a martyr at all. I think what it was is all comes down to his voice was people tuned him out. And that's a tough situation to be in. When you get tuned out by the fan base, you have to imagine that you're being tuned out inside. If outside's tuning you out, inside forces have already either tuned you out or they're starting to. And I wonder, and I'll never know this answer, you know, was he being tuned out in the team? And I don't know that answer. Honest to God, I don't know that answer. But, you know, it's not a secret that the relationship of him and Barnhart was not good. I mean, it wasn't bad, but I think it was kind of like they were tired of each other, you know, and I think they were tired of, you know, dealing with each other, dealing with the circus, if you will. You know, I think you're right, Scotty. I do. I think he was burned out at a point. I would agree with that. I would also say that he was just tired. He's just tired, you know. And I would understand that. I respect that, you know. But again, you know, I appreciate what he's done. You know, like I said, 15 years, 4 Final Fours, 47 draft picks, 3 number one picks overall with Davis, Wall, and Towns. You know, 2 Elite Eights, 32 NCAA wins, 6 SEC titles, 410 wins overall. You know, he done everything that his contract said to do. It did. But I think that it really rubbed a lot of people raw that he got the whole lifetime contract. And I think a lot of people thought, well, he's untouchable. He's untouchable. We can't do anything. We can't get rid of him because if you fire him, you got to come up with $33 million. And I know that that money could be gotten. You know, I was watching, I'm a big history guy. I was watching the Watergate documentary on CNN. And, you know, Richard Nixon looks at John Dean and says, how much is it going to cost to get rid of these people? And he said, I can't imagine. And again, in the 60s, it has to be over $1 million. And you know, Nixon comes up and says, well, we can get it. We could have got $33 million. I have to think that the money was there, or it could have been there. But again, Cal done us a solid by going to Arkansas, by resigning the $33 million you don't have to come up with. It was an ugly split, but it could have been a lot worse for a lot of reasons. The money among that. So, that being said, you know, I wish him well in Arkansas. I do. I think he'll do a good job down there. I really do. He'll get them to drink the Kool-Aid. I can tell you that, because if there's one thing John Calipari can do, he can sell it. He can sell the program that he's going to put in there. And, you know, they need that. I mean, Arkansas is kind of a second tier. If you can imagine, if you had a blue blood 7 to 8 teams. That next group down, that second group, Arkansas could be in that category. They have a history of success. They won a national title with Nolan Richardson. The Final Fours in the 70s and 80s. Players like Alvin Robertson, Sidney Moncrief, Corliss Williamson, Lee Mayberry, Todd Day. I mean, it goes on. I mean, they've had guys. They've had dudes that can play. So, Cal will do all right there. And he'll get them lined out and things, and he'll bring in talent. He will, and I'm sure some of the kids that were committed to Kentucky will wind up in Arkansas. You just figure they will be. So, again, I wish Cal the best and stuff, and I think everybody is ready to turn the page. I think they're ready to move on. So, the big name right now that we are hearing is Scott Drew. And I've kind of done some digging because that's the kind of person I am. I'm going to dig around and see what I can find and talk to some people. And guys, I'm going to tell you something. Scott Drew can coach. But man, there's 8 coaches currently coaching that have won a national title. 8. He's one of them. And I've heard about it, it was during the COVID years. Oh, this, well, that, well, water. Well, somewhere you get water from. I mean, give the man credit. He can coach. He has to be able to coach. If you look at it, I'm going to show you something. I want you to see something. Something that I found that I think it is a very, very good determination about him as a coach. Here, I think this says it a lot. I was looking on Spotify, and I'm listening to his book, The Road to Joy. It's his biography from the Baylor years. And if you can't see it right there, I'll read it. It says, when Drew accepted a head coaching position at Baylor in 2003, the job was arguably the worst in all of college sports. The men's basketball team had been disgraced by scandal. One player murdered a teammate, and the head coach who lied about the details tried to conceal illegal cash payments to his players, including a false allegation that the murdered player had been dealing drugs. It was an unprecedented story and a national embarrassment. Still, Coach Drew had a confident vision of what the program could be, even in the face of such adversity, and he guided the team to the pinnacle of success, Baylor's first national title, while leading with and living out his faith. Now, I think we can all agree that the Kentucky job is not that. Not that. No. Not that. But what I think that says is, this guy can handle pressure. If you think about pressure, when he went into Baylor in 2003, he had 0 players on a roster. 0. When he went into Baylor, he didn't have the NCAA in there, just the NCAA. He had legal. The police was in there. And a player murdered another player, had drugs, you had cash. I mean, it was a mess. I tell you what, for your homework till next week, and especially if Drew gets hired at Kentucky, on YouTube, there is a special about the Baylor, the whole big cover-up. It's on, I can't remember what the name is. Search Baylor basketball, and it'll pop up. Watch that, and see how bad it really was at Baylor. Now, considering all that and all them things, he turned that program around. He absolutely, through his faith and his perseverance, they didn't even go through probation once. A few years later, his assistants, took the program under and went through another probation, and still yet wound up winning a national title there. And I've seen where a lot of people have said, 7 or 8 years. They didn't make it out of first weekend and things. Okay, fair point. But in the last whatever years, how many good coaches can you say that about too? So you can't just say, hold out, okay, Scott Drew is the only coach that has absolutely not had good weekends at the NCAA tournament. You can't say that. So, you know, the man obviously can coach to start with. And I'm not, for Shane talking, I'm all right with him. I am. Because is he the home run hire that everybody wanted? More than likely not. Probably not. You know, everybody wanted names like Jay Wright. He ain't coming, guys. Nate Oates ain't coming. Danny Hurley ain't coming. And, you know, you can go on from there. Billy Donovan, if it gets to Billy Donovan, I don't know that Billy Donovan comes. I mean, he's winning in the NBA, you know. I don't think it's a done deal that he would come. Brad Stevens, he ain't coming. All these guys, you know, that are these great names and stuff, if they're not coming, they're not coming. Supposedly Hurley was offered up to $11 million a year, somewhere in that crazy numbers. If that kind of money is not bringing him to Lexington, going back over and over again, you know, and saying, well, what would it take this time? What would it take this time? Well, sooner or later, I mean, you know, certain people are not going to take the job. If these guys don't want to take it, I mean, it wouldn't do Barnhart any good to get on a plane and sit on the front porch and say, okay, until you decide you're coming to Kentucky, I'm going to sit right here and I'm going to wait on you. Can't. The business of coaching is moving now. You've got the portals open right now. Over 1,000 players in the portal. Recruiting. You've got your class in line right now. Baylor, I think I've seen the number six recruiting class in America right now. Okay, you got that. So decisions are being made by the second, guys, over and over and over. Kentucky can't wait a month on Danny Hurley. Kentucky can't wait a month on Nate Oates. Kentucky can't wait till the playoffs are over to deal with Billy Donovan. You can't wait. You can't. You have to take the best available guy when you can get him. Okay? So if it's Scott Drew is the best we can get at this juncture in time, you better take him. You better take him. The man's won 466 games for about a 60-50 winning percentage, somewhere in there. He's 17-9 in the NCAA tournament, 10-3 in the NIT, and I know everybody wants to, oh, God, it's over the NIT. Quit. Look at the NIT this year. Tell me that Iowa or Indiana State and Seton Hall didn't need to be in the tournament. I rest my case. So don't tell me about that. You know, he's won a national title in 21. You know, he's won 2 Big 12s. He's 3-time Big 12 Coach of the Year. I mean, what are we asking for the guy, you know? I mean, think about what he went through. Some of the things, like I said, every player in the program was let go in 2003. He was on probation for that until 2010. So from 2003 to 2010 is 7 years of probation. Had no postseason in 03 and 04, 2 separate years. And yes, he went 8-21 and 9-19 his first 2 seasons. But I'm going to tell you something. If you get rid of a program, I tell you what, if we can get Rick Pitino on here, ask Rick Pitino what it's like to try to put a program together when you don't have talent. When you got 8 guys that you figure Eddie Sutton was going to put right near, if they weren't into the starting five, they were sure on the bench. Yeah, I'm telling you. The one kid they had back then that would have played either way was John Pelper, and he was in rotation. Feldhaus wasn't, Farmer wasn't, Woods might have played a little bit. Reggie Hanson probably wasn't going to play a lot. Jonathan Davis wasn't going to play a lot. Derek Miller probably would have started. And that's 7 of the 8 right there. So don't tell me. Don't tell me that. The man can coach, and he can recruit, and he can build, and he can sustain. I like that word, sustain. He can sustain and stabilize the program. Scott Drew can. So I'm on board. I am. I'm not saying he's the best we can get. He's not. And I'll be honest with you. And I told Andrew and Cameron, my nephews, today. He's not my first pick. So don't think I'm sitting here thinking I'm beating the war wagon for Scott Drew. I'm not. Because in my opinion, the coach I would like to see in Lexington is Chris Beard. And I know what you're also, oh my gosh, Shaq, what are you thinking? He had all this domestic violence and all this rigmarole. Yeah, he did. But, I mean, you give people chances. You know, he's winning at Ole Miss. You know, Ole Miss saw enough to give him a chance. And I know it's Ole Miss compared to Kentucky. I understand that. But if this happens 3 years ago, John Calipari leaves 3 years ago, Chris Beard is the number one pick to take that job. Go back and look what he was doing at Texas before all that scandal. Chris Beard would have been top 2 or 3 anyways to take the Kentucky job. It's the truth. So, you know, that's my thinking. It's just my thinking. Again, me and Barnhart don't talk, so don't think that me and him's on. I got him on my cell phone thinking, hey, I'll call him. No, we're not doing that. But again, you know, I think being relative here, thinking this thing through, right now at this juncture in time, Scott Drew ain't a bad bet. And I would be interested. You guys that are watching, I'd be interested to hear your thoughts. Comment on this thing. Let me, if I'm wrong, tell me I'm wrong. I'm good with that. That's the beauty of sports radio, a beauty of sports podcasts. You don't have to agree with me, and I'm good with that. I'm okay with that. You don't have to agree with me. But you might. And that, if you do, that's great too. You know, but sometimes we just agree to disagree. And I don't feel like that is a bad pick. I really don't. That's my take on Scott Drew. That's just kind of the way I see it breaking down. You know, and I've looked at, you know, I found some odds on, this was about a few days ago. Here are odds for the next Kentucky, next head basketball coach. You look at that list right there. Nate Oates, yeah, I'd take. No question. Richard Pitino, that ain't Rick. Richard, his boy. I would be upset with that. You're better with Scott Drew. Billy Donovan, I'd be good with Billy. Then you get in the group, Mark Pope, former Kentucky player, coaching at BYU. I don't know that he's ready yet for that. Kelvin Sampson, with his age, I don't know. But I love what he does defensively, so I wouldn't be upset with that. Sean Miller, I don't know how Sean Miller got on this list. I really don't. I don't know. You know, I don't know. I'm not taking Sean Miller. But Jamie Dixon, again, I'm all good on Dixon. Chris Beard, I'm telling you, this happens 3 years ago, Chris Beard's my pick. Rick Pitino, if Rick wasn't 70, 71-year-old, yeah. Younger Pitino, maybe. But I don't think that's going to happen. Scott Padgett, nah. Shaka wouldn't be a bad pick. I like Shaka Smart. I lean defense, guys. I do. I'm a defensive guy, so That's where I lean. TJ Osselberger, I think he's just too young right now. It's not the fact he can't coach. I think he's young. Bruce Pearl, I love Pearl. I do. But I don't think that they would throw him the keys. Will Wade, you know, the things that he went down for at LSU are legal now. So I wonder, you know, the whole stained, oh my gosh, he's stained, whatever. I mean, I don't think Will Wade's getting it. Penny Hardaway, no, that could be a train wreck right there. The whole recruiting, the way he recruits, he gets talent, but he's kind of Calipari with a little bit unhinged. So, you know. But Bobby Hurley, no, we ain't getting Bobby Hurley, Hunter. No, we ain't doing that. Danny Hurley plus 2,500. He's not coming, guys. Jay Wright ain't coming. I like Tommy Lloyd. That would be my second pick behind Chris Beard. I don't think Tommy Lloyd's coming. Mick Cronin, ain't no way he's coming. No. Brad Underwood, 3,300. I like Brad Underwood. I don't think he's coming to that. Shaheen Holloway at some point will be a Blue Bud coach. I love him. Love him, but I don't think he's ready for that environment. You know, I'm pissed off that they left her name out. I tell you what, Spank, you go on down there and if they want me, I'll put gas in the old car and I'll drive her to Lexington. Alrighty. Dan Griffin says, you know, I'm all ball coach. But I agree with you 100%. Situational timing right now, he's most realistic. That's what I say. If this is happens, say Kentucky just gets beat and gets put out, and they're not even in the NCAA tournament, you might have got one of those other names because you had time. But right now, time is the essence here. It's of the essence. You have got to make a move. And inactivity is just as bad as the wrong decision, probably worse, because what happens is the clock's running. So if it's running, you're going to have to at some point pull the trigger and make a call. And I think you could do a whole – I appreciate it, Spank. I wish I could say that. But, again – you've got to make that call. You don't. I'll be honest with you. If this gets, I'm going to say to next week, let's say a week from now, I'm having this show and we still haven't hired a head basketball coach at Kentucky. We got problems. We got some serious issues coming up. And we can't wait. We cannot wait. Call's got to be made. And we got to get the right guy in place right now. And, you know, the situation is warranting make a call. You can't wait this thing out. And here, because of the portal, because of recruiting, you can't wait. Those two things are pressing needs. Because everybody else is out there saying, okay, you signed, you committed to Kentucky. Your coach just moved. How do you know the guy they're going to get is somebody you can play for? You know, coaches get in people's ears. You know, I think so too, Corey. I really do. His job is on the line. It is. So if my job is on the line, and I know that my job is on the line, I got to make the best call I can make now. You can't think this thing out. You can't just keep processing it. It's not 89 no more. It's not even 2009 anymore. It's now. We're here now. And now says we got to have a coach. And I think if we're in that parameter, if we're where we are as a program now, we got to have a coach. Scott Drew's call. Give me Scott Drew. Give me Scott Drew. I think the other guys, like I said, I'm a Chris Beard guy. I'll always like Chris Beard. At some point, a blue blood will pull the trigger on Chris Beard. Somebody will take a shot at him, especially next year. If Ole Miss, I think they have a top 25 class. If they have a big year, somebody will take a look at Beard again. A UCLA. You know, I don't think Mick Cronin's on stable ground out there in Westwood. I don't. So, you know, and Bill Self at some point is going to retire. Kansas may come open. I mean, Hubert Davis, a great coach, but how long is he going to stay at Carolina? John Shire at Duke is there for a while. He's young. Yeah. Danny Hurley's not leaving Connecticut, guys. I'm sorry. I'd love to have Danny Hurley. I would. I'd be tickled to death. He's not coming. Truth's the truth. He's not coming. So, I mean, there's a lot of movement here. You know, here's the thing. Kentucky's got to be moving instead of waiting. Because waiting is just as bad as not hiring. So, that's my two cents on Scott Drew and the Rick. And then, it's not Rick Pitino. Whew, Rick must be talking about me. On John Calipari. So, what are we talking about? What are we talking about here? Let's talk about what's brewing coming up right now. If you will look right here, let's kind of change gears a little bit. If you, it's a 2024 NBA mock draft. If you look right there, number two overall, Rob Dillingham, who has just committed to go pro. He has signed an agent. He will not come back to the college of ranks. Is the number two pick overall by Washington. If you look right down there at number six overall, you will see the name Reed Shepherd going to the Toronto Raptors in the lottery. So if that's the case, if Reed Shepherd is a lottery pick, one of the top 14 picks, Reed Shepherd will not be back at Kentucky. Or he shouldn't be back at Kentucky, in my opinion. The difference between making great NIL money, $1-2 million. It's still $1-2 million. I agree, but it's generational money in the lottery. For that means his grandkids will be set for life. How do you pass that up? So, again, Dilly at two. I mean, yeah, I agree with that all together. Shep in the top six. Yeah, he's got to go. He's got to go pro. He's got to go, guys. I'm sorry. I love Reed Shepherd. I do. What he's done for Kentucky is nothing short of amazing. He's got to go. He's got to go with that kind of money. We know that Aaron Bradshaw, 7-foot center, is in the portal right now. Joey Hart, a little used guard from Indiana, is in the portal right now, along with Adu Thierro. He's in the portal right now. So we have three in the portal. Coming on the show tonight, or coming when he's getting on the air, forward Jaden Quaintance has reopened his recruiting. He is available now, along with, what's the kid's name? Carter Knox. So two of the recruits are already open, and we still have, I think, four or five right there that have not made their decision yet. One of them being Travis Perry. You know, Kentucky legend. I don't know that he goes anywhere. Hard to say. But again, it's starting to open up now. You got people moving and leaving. So that's why I keep saying Kentucky has got to get something going in a hurry. Kind of switch gears here. Tara Vanderveer. If you know a little bit about women's basketball, you've heard that name. Stanford legend. One of the top four or five coaches of all time, has made her decision to retire as head basketball coach at Stanford, over 1,500 wins. Yeah, legend, GOAT, put her on a pedestal. She deserves it. So Vanderveer will be open. Another coach you might have heard of, one of my favorite coaches of all time, many ways, but now definitely – Josh Schertz is leaving Indiana State. He will be named a new coach. He has been named a coach at St. Louis for a six-year, $12 million deal plus incentives. I think from what I've gathered that he got a really good NIL package to come. St. Louis, it's a little bit, you know, if you look at Indiana State being in the Missouri Valley, good basketball conference, good play, good teams. I think the Atlantic 10 is maybe a step up as far as who they play. And St. Louis, he can build that program in his mold of how he wants to build that. So I'm all with you. I sent him a message on Messenger and told him, I said, look, I don't know what a Billiken is, but I'm for you. You know, we'll figure that out as we go, but I want to congratulate him. He's a better man than he is a coach, and you see how good a coach he is. So, congratulations, coach. I'm all behind you, no question about it. Going on, Kentucky women's. We got a lot of movement there. Kenny Brooks, coach of Virginia Tech, has taken a job. I think he's been about 2 weeks now, maybe a week, maybe just a week. I get time confused. I'm old. Work with me. But again, we have signed his All-American point guard, Georgia Moore, from Australia. If you've not heard of her, you're about to. She's an All-American point guard, and she is the all-time leader in assists with 656. In assist turnover ratio, 1.8 to 1. I put to you this way, as a basketball coach, if your team has a 2-to-1 ratio assist to turnover, you are playing elite basketball. By herself, she is almost 2-to-1 assist to turnover ratio. That's unbelievable. Minutes played, she averages 34 minutes a night on the court. She's second all-time in three-pointers made with 330 at Virginia Tech, and the third all-time leading scorer with 1,853 points. So we are getting an absolute monster point guard. And anybody will tell you, if you're building a program, you better have a point guard. And we've got one coming. So we got that. We have two kids that have remained in the program from Kyra Elzey's teams are Cassidy Rowe, Kentucky girl, Sanaya Tyler, a junior guard. So we got those two. We have Georgia Amore. And today it was announced that we have Clara Strack. I'm sorry. 6'5" center from Buffalo, New York. Played for Coach Brooks at Virginia Tech and started for him when his All-American center, Elizabeth Kitley, blew her knee out. So she averaged almost 10.5 rebounds in her starter minutes for Virginia Tech. So we're getting a player there as well. We're in good shape with that. So I look for more to be added this week. We will have the ability – put her on the men's team. I hear you. We'll keep adding to that list. And he also, before the show started, Brooks hired his first assistant from Moorhead. Tyler was her last name. Courtney Tyler, I think it is, was his assistant at Vautech. She's coming with him to Lexington, so that's our first assistant. She has Moorhead from Marshall in the Ohio area, All-American in Ohio, high school American, so knows the area. Should be able to recruit that area well. So we got those things to talk about. Let's talk a little bit about, by the way, about Indiana State. If you watched that team, you saw a guy named Robbie Avila, a center for Indiana State, mid-major All-American. Called him Kareem Abdul-Jabbar or Larry Nerd because of his glasses, whatever. Kid is an absolute baller. He is in the portal now. My guess is he's going to St. Louis to be with Shirts. That's a guess. Not been officially named that yet. But five starters for Indiana State are either transferring into the portal or graduating. So, you know, St. Louis could get really good really quick. That's what I'm trying to say. Let's talk baseball. Baseball. All right. Kentucky baseball right now is 27-5. 11-1 in the SEC. They are going into a series this weekend, the Thursday-Saturday series at Auburn. And right now, Kentucky has won 15 of its last 17 games. They are 9-1 at night, 9-2 on the road, 11-3 overall on the road. And they have a current 7-game winning streak in SEC play. So, Nick Mangione, one of the best baseball coaches in America, my opinion, doing some wonderful things with our baseball team, ranked number 8 in America this week. So, congratulations to the Batcats. Remember when they were called Batcats? I know you do. All right, so we move on to Kentucky football. We'll end with that. I got an article here from on3.com that says Kentucky looks better with Brock Vandegrift than Devin Leary. Okay. So national media tabbed Kentucky a sleeper this time last offseason, but the Wildcats never woke up under former NC State quarterback Devin Leary. That was a hurt. That one hurt. Mark Stoops and company took another swing at a transfer signal caller this offseason and landed Brock Vandegrift from Georgia. I like it. Team sources at Kentucky said the difference between Leary and Vandegrift has been night and day, and they are confident the former Bulldog and new offense coordinator Bush Hamden can take the Wildcats offense to new heights. Woo-hoo! That's what I'm talking about. There's a difference between transferring in and transferring in and taking a role. Devin Leary got put to quarterback position last year, but Vandegrift has actually grabbed the role by the throat. Woo! Heck yeah. That's not necessarily something they felt that Leary did last year. There's also much more tempo being injected into the offense. They are going to run a lot more plays under Hamden. That's something Mark Stoops has really prioritized this fall and is coming to fruition. I'm excited. I'm excited for Kentucky football. Pre-anything right now, I will make my prognostication. Kentucky wins 9 games next year, at least 9. Put me in for Kentucky at 9-3. That's what I'm thinking. Good coffee. Good coffee tonight. Got a nice iced coffee blend with Southern Butter Pecan. Yeah, it's right now. It's good stuff. All right, time to close her up, guys. Really appreciate you hanging out with me tonight. I'm tickled to death that you decided to hang out with me and hear me rattle and roll about Kentucky basketball. And, you know, like I said, it's been a tough week as far as getting information for Pineville, Bell, and Millsboro because of spring break last week. Getting back into a routine now. Right now, Pineville is playing in the All-A semis in softball at LMU, playing Jackson County right now, waiting to give some word on that game. So we're excited for that. Again, baseball get going. Weather's not been great. Tomorrow, I think, it's supposed to be stormy, so I don't know how that'll all play on games and stuff. So we'll get that. I need to get some information on track, so if you see anybody from, you know, anywhere in our local areas doing track, even in Harlan County, send it to me. I'd be glad to talk about it. Spring sports is not just baseball, softball. So, again, we'll get a better jump on local sports next week. Of course, I'll have some more information that I can put together for you guys. Looking forward to that. I'm glad everybody that saw it. If you can see this, obviously you survived the eclipse, and I'm tickled to death for you. You didn't burn your eyes out. So congratulations on that. Something to be proud of. But anyways, I do want to thank my sponsors again. Again, I can't do what I do without the sponsors. And my sponsors have been nothing short of remarkable. So I do want to thank them once more time. Home Helpers is my title sponsor, of course. Lemonade's Boutique, Blue Room Billiards Hall, Pineville Pawn Shop, and our new one, Mike Taylor, for Bell Commonwealth Attorney. Thank you guys so much again. And again, I can't do any of this that you see around me. It's because people had faith in me to do a show. So, and my dog is... decided that the Laundry Basket must go. So Rupp is destroying it as we speak. Back to sponsorship. I thank you so much. I sincerely do. And again, of course, Home Helpers is our title sponsor. And again, home is where your heart is with Home Helpers in Southeastern Kentucky. Your loved ones can continue to enjoy the comforts of home as they age. Our trusted, experienced caregivers provide exceptional care where and when needed to help make life easier. From companionship to housekeeping to meal prep to transportation, we will create our care plan that's tailored to fit your needs and budget. Keep the heart of your family at home with Home Helpers. Call 606-657-9441 today for a free in-home consultation. Or find us at homehelpershomecare.com/London, Kentucky. Home Helpers, making life easier. So thank you so much for Home Helpers. Can't appreciate everything they do for us. All right, so Cricket says, Chip Gaines versus Kentucky fans saga on Twitter. Oh, my gosh. We can't go against Magnolia Network. Can we beat Magnolia Network? Magnolia Network. Kentucky basketball. I don't know. Chip and Joanna's got it going, guys. They got a network. They got a magazine. They do it all. They do it all. They are a media conglomerate. Kentucky is. Let me show you what Kentucky is. So, this when somebody looks at you and says, "Well, what about Kentucky basketball? They're down. They're this. They're that." Grab hold of that right there. 8 national titles. 4 runner-ups, bunch of Final Fours, even more Elite Eights, even more Sweet 16s, and even more Round of 32. So I think we're pretty good at what we do. So I think we can beat Chip and Joanna. I would hope so. Anyways, I'm just kidding. I like Chip and Joanna. I do. All right, man. Yeah, he is Baylor alumni. And I listened to Cricket. I was listening to the audio book of Scott Drew, and I was just laughing. I'm sitting here thinking, you know, he said all this great stuff about Coach and Coach Drew and stuff, and we may be pulling him from Baylor. Who knows? But, again, I thank you guys so much for your support. Next week we will hopefully can talk about our new head coach. That may come down. Look for somewhere around Thursday to Friday. In my eyes, a decision we made somewhere around there. Thursday or Friday, somewhere in there, I think will be the time that Kentucky names their next head coach. So again, you know, I appreciate your time. I appreciate, you know, everything that you do for me. And again, gotta listen to my headphones. I don't want to blow you guys away on there with my speakers. Again, come back next week. We'll talk about it all over again. So it's time to hang the sign, guys. Thank you for coming to the shop. I wish you nothing but love. I wish you nothing but peace and joy. Come back and see me. Love y'all. Thank you. Take me home. I know who I want to take me home. I know who I want to take me home. Take me home. Closing time. Time for you to go out to the places you will be from. Closing. This room won't be open till your brothers or your sisters come. So gather up your jackets, move it to the exits. I hope you have found a friend. Closing.